Batmashini from EEE department. I'm at deemed to be university. Today I am going to give lecture on root locus technique in control system. Root locus technique. Actually, root locus technique is a very important topic in control system. First we have to learn what is a root locus technique. Root locus technique means it's actually a graphical method used to find out the stability of the system. So if you are designing a system, the stability is very, very important. So using this root locus technique, we are going to find out the stability of the system. And also, if you see, means the root locus technique, we are taking the open loop system. It may be in the control system, we are having both open loop as well as the closed loop system. This root locus technique is mean for a open loop system. So we are taking and considering a open loop system. The open loop system can be represented by g of s into h of s, which is equal to some equation on transfer function. So g of s into, I am taking the example, g of s into h of s, which is equal to k divided by s into s square plus 4s plus 13. So this is a transfer function and this is a open loop transfer function. So we are considering this equation and we are going to derive the root locus technique. We are going to apply the root locus technique. Initially there are some steps, there are various steps in the root locus technique which we have to find out, and finally we are arriving at the stability of the system. So if you are having a open loop transfer function, the transfer function contains many of the details. So if you see the open loop transfer function, here we are having the denominator term as well as the numerator term. So the denominator term means which tells us the number of poles present in the system, and in the numerator term that tells us the zero. So the numerator term gives you the zeros of the system and the denominator term gives you the poles of the system. So the first step in the root locus technique is the step one. We need to find out how many poles and how many zeros are present in the open loop system. Okay, so already I mentioned in the numerator we are having the zeros and in the denominator we are having the poles. So if you see this example which is having only no zeros are present, only poles are there. So the first step is we have to find out the poles and zeros. So no zeros for this system, only poles are there. So the next step is we have to find out what are the poles. So if you see the poles means s power 0 or s power 1, this is s power 1. So the poles here, the poles equal to s equal to 0, and the second poles will be from s square plus 4s plus 13 equal to 0. So if you find out means s which is equal to minus 2 plus or minus j3, a complex pole is there. So we found out the poles and zeros. One pole s equal to 0, the second pole will be s equal to minus 2 plus or minus j3. So totally in this system we are having 3 number of poles. So we found out the first step in root locus technique is we have to find out how many number of zeros and poles are there. We found out the number 3 number of poles are there. So why we are finding out this is based on the number of poles only, we are telling that this system is having this much number of root locus. So here we are having 3 number of poles. So 3 root locus branches are there. three root locus branches are there. Then we have to identify where the root locus are present, because we are going to plot the root locus in an ordinary graph sheet. So we have to find that one, whether where the root locus are present. So the next step is we found out the number of poles, then we have to plot the thing in the graph. So I am drawing the graph like this. This will be the 0 point, then 1, 2, then 3, then 4, 5, 6, then minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, then minus 4, then minus 5, then minus 6. So it goes on up to infinity. So here also the imaginary term, then J1, then J2, J3, J4, J5, here minus J1, minus J2, then minus J3, minus J4, then minus J5. So we know the poles. What are all the poles? S equal to 0, then S equal to minus 2 plus or minus J3. So plot here S equal to, and again one thing, in the root locus technique we have zeros and poles. So we have to mark the zeros and poles in the graph. So if you are having a zeros, that zero should be marked by a circle, and if you are having poles, that are marked by a cross symbol with a circle. So zeros are marked by zero symbol and the poles are marked by a cross with a circle. So here we are having three poles, so mark the poles in the graph sheet. So poles, what are all the poles? S equal to 0, S equal to minus 2 plus or minus J3. So S equal to 0 means this will be one pole, right? Then S equal to minus 2 plus or minus J3. So S equal to minus 2 plus or minus J3 means one pole will be here and the next pole will be here, minus J3. So the poles, this thing is over, marking the poles and zeros. The next step is we have to find out the root locus. How many root locus are there? We are telling that three poles are there, so three root locus are there. Then we have to find out the root locus. For the root locus, place a test point here. In the negative, behind the pole, place a test point. And test the test point, if this is the test point, and after the test point if there are odd number of poles or zeros. So if your test point is here, you count the number of poles. Here we are having only one pole, so odd number of poles. So this line up to infinity, because here there are no poles or zeros, so the entire negative real axis should be a root locus. So mark this as a root locus. So this will be our first root locus. So the next thing is, I already told that we are having three root locus, so one root locus branch I marked. So again two root locus branches are remaining, so we have to mark that one. For that one we are having some certain steps, so five or six steps are there that we have to find out. For the second step, is plotting the root locus. The third step, to find out the remaining root locus, for that one the step 3 will be, we have to find out the centroid and the angle of asymptotes. Centroid means sum of poles minus sum of zeros divided by n minus m. Sum of poles minus sum of zeros divided by n minus m. So sum of poles means you take the sum of poles and there is no zero, so leave the zero. Sum of poles means we are having the pole, what are all the poles? 0, then minus 2 plus j3, minus 2 minus j3 divided by n minus m. N be the number of poles in the system and m be the number of zeros in the system. Here m equal to 0, so n equal to 3. So here the value will be 3, so which is equal to, if you do the calculation you get minus 1.33. The value will be minus 1.33, that is the centroid. Then we have to find out the angle of asymptotes. Angle of asymptotes, the formula will be phi, the angle which is equal to plus or minus 180 degree into 2q plus 1. Where this q value will be varying from 0, 1 up to n minus m minus 1. So you substitute the values for q equal to 0, 1. What is here? N minus m minus 1 means n which is equal to 3, m equal to 0, so minus 1, so 2. So substitute the values for q from 0, 1, 2. So you get the values for phi. If you substitute the values, the phi value will be equal to plus or minus 60 degree. Then for q equal to 1, the value will be plus or minus 180 degree. And then for q equal to 2, the value will be plus or minus 300 degree. This is the angle of asymptote. So we completed the poles and zeros, number of poles and zeros, and we plotted it in the graph. Then we found out the centroid. So we found out the centroid point will be equal to minus 1.33. So take here the minus 1.33. This is minus 1. So this point, which is the minus 1.33, and the angle will be 60, 180, 300, which is a multiple of 60 degree. So take a 60 degree and plot the asymptotes. So this will be the asymptotes, and this angle will be equal to 60 degree. Here also 60, here also 60 degree. This point will be equal to minus 1.33, which is the centroid point. Okay, then the same thing, we have to find out the remaining two root locus. The next step is we have to find out, the fourth step will be we have to find out the breakaway and the break-in point. Breakaway and break-in point. Where we are having this breakaway and breaking point means breakaway point. Breakaway point means if we are having two poles or two zeros in the negative or the positive real axis, then we can expect the breakaway and the break-in points. Now if you see, means here only one pole is at the origin. There are no poles in the negative or the positive real axis. So there is no breakaway points. There is a method to find out the breakaway and break-in points. From this thing also, from the graph also, we can say that there is no breakaway and break-in points, since here no poles or zeros in the negative real axis. If zeros are there, then we are having the break-in points. If poles are in the negative real axis, we are having the breakaway points. So here there is no poles or zeros in the negative real axis, no breakaway break-in points. We can go to the step 5. In step 5, we have to find out the angle of departure or angle of arrival. Angle of departure or angle of arrival. So for this one, for angle of arrival and angle of departure, there is a formula, and here in this system there is no zeros. So if zeros are there, then we can find out the angle of arrival. If poles are there, we are having the angle of departure. Why this angle of departure is there means we are having complex poles, no complex zeros. If complex zeros are there, then we can tell that is the angle of arrival. Since only complex poles, this poles minus 2 plus j3, minus 2 minus j3 is there, only angle of departure is there, and there is a formula to find out the angle of departure. So how we can find out the angle of departure is, angle of departure which is equal to phi, we can name this as phi, phi d, angle of departure phi d, which is equal to 180 degree minus the angle of poles plus the angle of zeros with respect to the complex poles. So here no zeros are there, so we can leave this phi z. So the value will be 180 degree minus phi p. Then coming to this graph, if you see the graph means we have to find out the angle for the poles. So how we can find out the angle for the poles is, you take the complex pole. This is the complex pole. So mark a line from the complex pole. Mark a line from the complex pole to the, from the origin mark a line to the complex pole. Then this will be another one complex pole. So we have to find out this angle as well as this angle. This angle we know that this will be equal to 90 degree. But this one we have to find out. How we have to find out this angle will be. So if you take this phi p, take this phi p, phi p can be splitted up into phi p1 plus phi p2. Okay. So phi p1 means the angle of this one from the pole at the origin to the complex pole. This is 5P1. So this can be written as 5P1, which is equal to 180 degree minus tan inverse of this one, 3 divided by 2. 3 means this value and 2 means that is the adjacent, the opposite value divided by the adjacent value, that is tan inverse 3 by 2. So if you find out this value, 5P1, then again 5P2, what is 5P2? 5P2 means that is the angle, this pole with this pole, the angle between this pole, the imaginary pole in the complex pole at the negative axis to the complex pole at the positive axis. So that will be equal to, the 5P2 will be equal to 90 degree. So you substitute all these values in the 5D equation. So your 5D value will be equal to plus or minus 33.7 degree. So if you substitute all these values, if zeros are there means you try to draw a line from the zero to the complex pole, and the same procedure, you find out the value, substitute that value. So you finally get the 5D, which is equal to plus or minus 33.7 degree. So you have to draw this 5D value, you have to mark this angle of departure 5D plus or minus 33.7 degree. So from this complex pole, you draw the mark the angle, which is the 33.7 degree. This will be equal to 33.7 degree, and here also the value will be equal to 33.7 degree. So 33.7 degree, 33.7 degree we marked. So the fifth step over, we found out the angle of departure. The last step will be, we have to find out what is the crossing point. So we have to find out the root locus. So one root locus already we found out, the two root locus are remaining, and we already found out the asymptotes with the centroid point. So if asymptotes are there, normally the root locus will travel parallel to the asymptotes. So we can judge that my root locus, the two root locus will be passing parallel to this asymptotes. Then I have to mark where it crossed the imaginary axis. For that one, you take the characteristic equation. Characteristic equation means from this one we have to find out the characteristic equation, which is equal to 1 plus g of s h of s, which is equal to 0. This is your characteristic equation for this problem. So this is your step 6, the last step to find out the crossing point on the imaginary axis. So 1 plus g of s, so you substitute this equation. So 1 plus k divided by s into s square plus 4s plus 13, which is equal to 0. If you found out, you get the equation. So we have to find out the characteristic equation, 1 plus g of s h of s equal to 0. So your g of s h of s, that is the open loop transfer function, we are having this equation. So substitute here, 1 plus k divided by s square, s into s square plus 4s plus 13 equal to 0. So you find out the value, which is equal to s into s square plus 4s plus 13, s 13 plus k, which is equal to 0. So from this one, the last one, step 6, we have to find out the characteristic equation. Why we are doing this one is, we have to find out the crossing point of the root locus in the imaginary axis. So only we are doing all these things. So 1 plus g of s h of s equal to 0. So 1 plus k divided by s into s square plus 4s plus 13, which is equal to 0. So multiply this one, take the LCM. So s into s square plus 4s plus 13 plus k, which is equal to 0. So from this one, s cube plus 4s square plus 13s plus k equal to 0. The next thing is, finally, I initially told you root locus technique is used to find out the stability also. So from this one, we are going to find out the stability as well as the crossing point on the imaginary axis. So how to find out the stability of the system is, the stability of the system can be found out from Ruth-Hurwitz criterion. Ruth-Hurwitz stability criterion is there. So using that one only, we are going to find out the stability of the system. For that one, we have to arrange the characteristic equation. So that can be written as s cube, s square, then s, then s power 0. So s cube means which is equal to 1, then write the odd term 13, s square which is equal to 4, and this will be your k. So the next term you multiply this one, 13 into 4 minus k divided by this 4. So 52 minus k divided by 4. Then again you multiply this one, 52 minus k divided by 4 into k divided by 52 minus k divided by 4. This is the procedure for writing the characteristic equation in the Ruth-Hurwitz criterion. From this one only we are going to tell whether the system I took is stability or non-stability. So we are going to write here, these two terms get cancelled, the final term will be equal to k. So what we are going to do is, when the system is stable is all the terms, if there is no time sign change in the first column of this Ruth-Hurwitz criterion, if there is no sign change in the Ruth-Hurwitz criterion, then this system is known as a stable system. So what we are doing is, here we are having 52 minus k by 4 which is equal to 0. So my system, this k value should be greater than 50, should be less than 52. So if your k value should be less than 52 means what you are telling is there is no sign change in the system and the system should be stable. So we are telling if k equal to less than 52, then the system will be stable. Then we have to find out the crossing point on the imaginary axis. For that one, what we are doing is this one, you take this one, if you substitute, if k equal to 52, what will happen? This term will be 0. Okay. So if we substitute k equal to 0, this term will be 0. So if this term will be 0, according to the Ruth-Hurwitz criterion, we have to find out the auxiliary equation. So write the auxiliary equation, this will be your auxiliary equation. So 4 s square plus k which is equal to 0. So when you are getting this 0 value, when k equal to 52. So you substitute here, 4 s square plus 52 equal to 0. So 4 s square equal to minus 52. So s square equal to minus 52 divided by 4 which is equal to minus 13. So s equal to plus or minus j square root of 13. If you found out j 13, that value will be equal to plus or minus 3.06. This root 13 will be s equal to plus or minus j 3.06. This is your s equal to 3.06 means that can be marked here in the imaginary axis. So this is your 3.06. So what we are going to do is, so we found out the crossing point on the imaginary axis. Now draw the root locus. That root locus, already we found out the angle of departure. So that will be, that root locus will be drawn with this angle and it crossed the imaginary axis and it should go to infinity parallel to the asymptotes. That is the root locus. So here also take the, draw the root locus with this angle 33.7. It should meet, it would cross the imaginary axis at this 3.06 and it will be parallel to the asymptotes. So our ultimate aim, we have to find out the root locus, how many poles are there. Based on the number of poles, we are having the root locus. Initially, we found out the root locus. We got only one root locus in the left axis. So the next, the remaining two root locus, we have to find out. For that one only, we did this, all these six steps and found out which is the crossing point on the imaginary axis. And with that crossing point and the angle of departure, we draw the root locus, the second and the third root locus, which will be parallel to the angle of asymptote. So root locus is a graphical technique to find out whether the system, and also we found out the stability of the system. If the value of k is less than 52, the system will be stable. And also we can write the k value will be between 0 and 52. If this is the value for k, then the system should be stable. So we draw the root locus, we found out the stability, all these quantities, all these values we can get from the root locus technique. This is a efficient technique for finding out the stability of the system as well as to plot the entire details of a transfer function. So we saw the root locus technique. I explained all the things, how to find out the root locus techniques, how to find out if the some points are some points are not there, that breakaway points, break-in points. Why? Because means in the breakaway point, here there is no breakaway point. Why? Because means we are having the complex pole and the zero. So with this explanation, you can understand how we can proceed with the root locus technique to find out the stability of the system, as well as we can get the whole idea about the transfer function. We can get the poles detail, zeros detail, and a graphical method. Anyway, when you are using a graphical method, it is very very easy to understand easily. So this root locus technique is easy to find out the stability of the system and to locate all the poles and zeros in the graph. With this, I conclude the root locus technique. Thank you.